have so many people turned up because you have low self-esteem or because you want to help others with low self-esteem?
The title is catchy.
Title. So remind me, next time I'll make it even more catchier. Maybe we'll do something like, does Aishwarya Rai have low self-esteem? Question mark. So then we'll get even more people coming in. Okay, before I move on to the main topic, let me explain something very simple that most of us do. While we are, can't hear? How is it now? Yes. While as human beings we are basically concerned about our own selves and our own welfare and things of that sort, and we want the best out of life, the funny part is that we don't do sufficient introspection into what we need, what we have, what we can provide, where there is something lacking. We only look at external factors. A very oversimplistic anomaly could be that I want to go to a shop to buy a shirt, and I am going and looking for the best shop, and in every shop also I am asking him to show me 50 different shirts and all that. But before I even start on that process, have I checked out how much money I have to spend on a shirt? Have I checked out whether I have half a dozen blue shirts, so I need not, even if it's a good blue shirt, I should not buy because I already have six blue shirts, so let me buy some other color. That is what we need to do in order to make that whole process very effective. We don't do that. We just go looking and say, oh, this shop is too expensive, this shop doesn't have variety, this shop is this is there, I like this, I don't like this. So as I said, while it's oversimplistic, but it's actually true that even for our own needs, I want to be happy, I want to have good relationships, I want to have peace of mind and all that, we are looking for external sources. Can my friend provide me with company? Can he, an influential person, can he help me get a better job? Can this one do that? So when I say I want company, what am I offering to him so that he will give me good company? What am I capable of so that I can go to him and say, please help me get a better job? Anything of that sort, if I know where I stand, it's to make it even more simplistic, I'm asking, on the phone, I'm asking a friend, yes, come. I'm calling up somebody and asking them, please give me the directions to go to Jayanagar. And I'm not telling him where I am. First, I have to find out where I am. Maybe a little bit to say that, okay, from here I don't mind walking to the main road if there are buses over there, or I don't mind catching an auto to go to Shivaji Nagar and something of that sort. Then that person will take over and say, from here you can do this. So not only I need to know where I am, I also need to explain that if I am on the first main of Artinagar, where the initial thing where to go, and where I can come up to Shivaji Nagar. From there, is it better to take a bus or an auto or this or that or whatever it is, and which direction or which bus route or whatever, I can ask that. That is the basis, fundamental of this thing called self-awareness. Am I really aware of what I am, where I am, right from my upbringing to my characteristics, my traits, my likes, my dislikes, what makes me happy, what makes me unhappy, what are my suppressed desires, what are my frustrations in life? That is the type of self-awareness that we need to do. And that, self-awareness leads to a better search of identity. Who am I? Where do I want to be? What do I want to do? Ideally speaking, they should start with adolescence. When we are children, it is we are in a cocoon, where our elders and parents and teachers tell us what to do, and we also accept them. Because till that age, we think that, parents know everything. Suddenly when we come to adolescence, we realize that these poor things don't know anything at all in life, and they are so ignorant that I have to do everything, not only for myself, but maybe for them also. So, fine. That's a good thing to happen, and that happens automatically because of this biological process known as the activation of hormones and the onset of adolescence and stuff like that. But when it when this process starts,
very flattering.
Yes. Good money. So then comes thing that once I am, you know, started looking for an identity, what am I and where I need to go? Very simple day-to-day issues, like, you know, when you come to high school, do we encourage a child to find out what are his strengths and then decide whether he wants to be an engineer or teacher or lawyer or architect or doctor or whatever it may be? We just go by what is there in the market. Like I said, I want to go to the shop and buy. So we do career planning also based on the marketing of the shops. Oh, IIT, you get a good job, or doctor's Nobel profession, or this is very good. National law school means campus recruitment. What am I? Am I, you know, cut out to be a good lawyer or a better doctor or a better teacher or whatever it may be? That is where we fail. So this process that goes on actually decides how well and how good we can be. Here I also want to tell you about slight confusion that takes place between self-esteem and self-confidence. Okay. Again, I'll give you a very simple example. Confidence is to do with activities or skills. Do I have the confidence to ride a motorcycle? No, I don't. Why? For the simple reason, nobody has taught me. So even if I own a motorcycle, I will say, no, Baba, I can't ride it. I don't have the confidence. I'll fall down. Then what happens? Somebody teaches me, or I learn on my own. Over a period of time, I say, now I have a little confidence. Here and there in the locality, I can roam around, but if I have to go into the market area or something, I can't. I leave it and go by auto. Eventually, if I practice even more, I can say anywhere in the city, I can go on my motorcycle. I am confident. Then what happens? Let's say I buy a car and I stop using the motorcycle. 5 years later, I don't have a car and I want to use a motorcycle. I say, no, I don't have the confidence because I haven't, you know, ridden my motorcycle for the last 5 years. I still have a motorcycle, I still have a license, I have my own experience, but my confidence level has gone down primarily because I'm not sure after a gap of so many years whether I will be able to ride the motorcycle or not. And again, vice versa. Again, I spend a few days and again it goes up. So, confidence is related to a skill or an activity. I may say I'm very confident to drive a car because I do it every day. But I am no longer confident in driving a motorcycle. 10 years back when I was a youngster, I was more confident driving a motorcycle but not confident enough to drive a car. Now it has reversed itself. So, confidence has nothing to do with self-esteem and vice versa. Very often we make this mistake of saying that, you know, build up your confidence and self-esteem or something. We use it in conjunction. Confidence you can only build up with regard to particular skills or particular activities or particular line of action or whatever you want to call it. And it can keep going up and down. Whereas, coming to self-esteem, very closely connected to self-esteem is self-worth. It's a quantification of self-esteem. How worthy am I? Am I worth something in this world? And to whom? Do people around me find me worthy? Do they look up to me, or am I serving any purpose and that sort of thing? It's also sometimes referred to as self-concept. What is my concept about my own self? But as I said, most of these things are hardly ever done by us. When was the last time that you sat down and said, let me now review where I stand? Yes, 5 years back, I was an expert in this. I could ride a motorcycle, I could do this, I was doing that. But 5 years later down the line, where do I stand now? What is my self-awareness level? What is my concept? What is my all these type of things. We rarely do it, but the fact is that it affects our day-to-day life. Unless and until we build up our and maintain a certain level of self-esteem, all our talents and this thing is not going to be helpful to us. We don't benefit from the potential or the capabilities that we have, primarily because we don't consider ourselves worthy. You remember that children's story that was told, that there was this baby elephant which was caught in the jungle and brought to the circus. The owner had only a small thin rope, and he tied the baby elephant's leg and tied it to a pole. The baby was very upset being tied up, and he pulled and pushed and kicked and tried everything. But since he was a tiny creature, he couldn't break that rope. He tried for days and days and days, and he finally got tired and he accepted it that, okay, I have to live in captivity. Years went past. That tiny baby elephant became 10 feet tall. And he is still tied by that thin rope. So somebody came and asked the circus owner, are you mad? This fellow can give one kick and that rope will break and he'll run away. He said, you know that, I know that, the elephant doesn't know. He has been conditioned. When he tried so much and nothing happened, somewhere at his subconscious mind, he has understood that whenever the owner ties me with this string, why waste time? It hurt me last time when I was trying to kick and pull, my leg was hurting. So why even attempt it? And he has given up. Classic example of how we do it. This is of course a physical phenomenon. At the mental or emotional level, this is what we do. I am not capable, so why should I even try? That is where the self-esteem goes down. At the same time, I also want to caution you that people confuse high self-esteem with ego or pride or whatever it is. The simplest test of the thing is, if I say that no, I don't want to show off or boast to anybody, maybe people will think I have too much of an ego. Yes, I have achieved this, but I don't want to say that. Or even when somebody comes and tells me, Ali, today why don't you tell them that, yesterday or last month you did something great and all, why don't you announce? No, it's okay, what is there to tell, they won't like it. That itself is an indicator that I do not have a bloated ego, that I'm not, proud or boasting or whatever it is. And the reverse also holds true. If I say that, when I am, committing 1 hour of my valuable time to these people without charging money, I am going to spend half an hour out of that telling them how great I am and what all I have achieved. I feel I should do it. Now there you know that it's the reverse, that a person is so egoistic. So you don't have to worry. If the very fact that you are questioning that, if I try to raise my esteem and say yes, I'm capable of this, I want to do that, will it be egoistic? The very fact that you are questioning it, the answer is there, that it's not egoistic. There are very clear category of people who are egoistic and who are building up and having a good self-esteem. Because the line where your self-esteem stops is a very clear line. You don't go beyond that. Yet the word of caution is, okay, I don't want to boast, but very simple barometer of self-esteem. What do I do when somebody praises me? If somebody comes and says, you are good in this sort of thing. No, I'm not all that good, it's not that. Actually, Sridhar speaks much better than me, you should listen to him and this. Now that is a very clear indicator that I have low self-esteem. Achha, when you ask me, why is it that you, somebody was genuinely praising you, why didn't you accept it? What is the answer that I give to people? I don't want to boast. Where are you boasting? It is somebody else saying that you speak well, I liked your lecture, whatever it may be. I don't have to negate that person. Now you see the vicious cycle in which a person with low self-esteem gets caught. He refuses to accept, praise, and thereby puts off people. And genuinely going and telling Ali that I like this and I like this quality in you, and he's saying no. So what am I telling the other person? You stupid fellow, you don't know how to evaluate what is good and bad. Isn't it? At the subconscious level, next time, you're going.
Yeah, but it's like from the childhood, whenever somebody praises a child or something, the parents are always there,
I'm coming to that. Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
How he behaves.
In fact, that's what I'm coming to, what the importance that childhood and adolescence plays in our self-esteem. So first, I just wanted to clarify and tell you that this is what constitutes self-esteem. These are the parameters by which you can judge. The moment I am negating somebody by saying that no, don't praise me, I am not good enough. And worse than that, if I am comparing with somebody else. See, it may be a fact that somebody else is a much better speaker. We are not discussing him, no? It's the reverse of what angry people or egoistic people do. Supposing somebody comes to me and says, Ali, what sort of shirt you are wearing? It doesn't suit you. Yeah. As though your shirt is very great. Huh? Now, the discussion was not of his shirt or anybody else's shirt. The discussion was of my shirt. Either I have to accept it and say, thank you very much. Maybe I made a mistake, I'll change it. Or I can say, no, I think this suits me and I am happy with it. So be it. Or thirdly, tell me what is not suitable about this. What made you feel this way? One of the easiest ways to handle criticism is to make the person justify in a very simple tone, not in a confrontationist tone. Oh, I see, it's not suitable, is it? Why, is it about the color or is it about the this or that? Or something of that sort. The moment you ask him, that person gets stumped. And if the person was just trying to put you down, he knows that he has lost the battle. On the other hand, if he's your genuine friend who is giving you constructive criticism and wanted you to look better or improve or whatever it is, then he will say, no, this is the thing. At your age, you should not wear too bright colors. It looks more dignified if you wear sober colors. Whatever it is, he'll have some reason, which again, I can accept or reject. But at least now I know that his intention was good. So I can bring him closer and make him my friend or whatever it may be. Now I come to what Prithima said just now is absolutely right, that it all starts with childhood. Right from, as I've been telling, fears which are instilled into children. Even that affects self-esteem. You don't want your small child to go out on the road because he will wander off somewhere or something of that sort. But if you tell him very mature, logical things like, don't go out on the road and there is heavy traffic or something, he doesn't understand. So what the parent does with all good intention is, points out from the window, you see those auto rickshaws standing there, they are waiting to kidnap children who come out of their houses. If any child comes out alone from the house, they pick up that child and run away with that child. Now for a toddler, that's a very, very effective medium, and the child says, okay, I should not go out. And the parent's purpose has been served. Now I can relax, the child will not wander out of the house. What we forget is to undo it when the child grows up. Little later, it is our responsibility to tell the child that auto rickshaw drivers are not kidnappers. I used to tell you that just to prevent you from walking out of the house alone. Now that you have grown up, I want you to understand this. Okay. Two things happen because the parents don't take that trouble. One is he grows up becoming very judgmental. He starts categorizing people. Auto rickshaw drivers are bad. Later on, he doesn't think that they are kidnappers, but they are bad. They are not nice people. And that extends to others also. If auto rickshaw drivers are bad, probably bus conductors are also bad. If bus conductors are bad, somebody else is also bad. So my judgmentalism into categories of people increases. More than that, what I want you to be aware today on this topic is my confidence to face life, my ability to face life at a subconscious level goes down. When I'm told that I can't step out alone because I will be kidnapped, the kidnapping part of it disappears from my conscious mind as I grow up. I know that I'm now too big to be kidnapped by anybody, whether it's auto rickshaw driver or something. But somewhere it is lingering in my mind that I'm not good enough. So I want to go out and explore the world. I want to go to the shop and buy something. I want to walk down alone to school. I want to do something. No, I can't do it. And the same parent wonders, what's wrong with this child? I'm telling her that, okay, 10 days I have walked with you down to the school. It's just around the corner over here. Today, why can't you go? Bright early morning, 8, 9 o'clock. No heavy lorries or traffic or something. Just I'll help you cross the road. From there, it's just one straight, this thing. No traffic. Take that lane into the thing and reach. No, I can't do it. You come and take me. And instead of acknowledging that something went wrong in my parenting or my upbringing, that the child is not developing that ability to be able to go, what do I make a mistake? What's wrong with you? You're so grown up and this, you can't have this thing. Stupid girl, you see the other children? That one is in third standard, you are in fourth. That third standard girl goes alone. Here I am, consciously or unconsciously, bringing the self-esteem down. And remember that it does not restrict itself to walking alone to the school. That's what I said, that if it is just a skill that I can't walk alone, then it's okay. It is a confidence of being able to go alone and that can be rectified. But what it actually happens is that when the child goes afraid, disturbed, not knowing what will happen, something will happen, some vague memories are there about auto rickshaw drivers being kidnappers, when auto rickshaw comes and stops close to me, I go running over there. With all those fears, I land up in the school. When I land up in the school and the teacher asks me, why is your shoe not polished? Or why haven't you cut your nails? See, I am a bad boy or a bad girl. I can't even make my teachers happy. Or if it is academics, why is it that you didn't do your homework? Or why can't you do this simple sum which everybody else is doing? Again, it is coming down. And not restricted to that particular area. If I were to lose confidence and say, I am not good in mathematics and I accept it. I don't have the confidence to do this algebra or trigonometry. Nothing wrong with it, you can overcome it. But again, the role of the elders, whether it is teachers, parents and all that, what do we do? Instead of saying, you are poor in mathematics. You are not able to grasp. I have explained to you 5 times. But still you are not able to do this. Instead of doing that, we start making generalized statements. You are useless. All the time watching TV, where will you learn algebra? The TV has nothing to do with algebra. But by making that statement that all the time watching TV, that's why you are not doing algebra, what are you trying to tell the child? It is not just a lack of confidence in solving that mathematical problem, but in overall you are incompetent, incapable, useless, etc., etc., etc. The whole thing goes down. And that is what pulls down the self-esteem. So I want you to be aware that, you know, self-esteem is greatly made or destroyed before we come to adulthood. And that is the reason why you will see, if there are two adults who are facing similar setback or crisis or obstacles, one buckles and the other takes it up as a challenge. Inevitably, if you look into the history of both of them, you will find that the first one is a person with low self-esteem. Person feels I am not capable of something. And this leads to comparison with others. And self-derogatory statements. I've given an exercise in the booklet. You ask yourself very, you know, rationally, what were the put downers that, put downers is the word that we use. That means, with what words or with what actions did your significant adults put you down? It could be a simple thing like, you know, some guest has come and my father is telling my mother, go and call Ali, let him meet this uncle and auntie. I am close by. I am almost willing to come. I am a shy boy, I don't enjoy, I hesitate. But because daddy is saying it, I would have come and done it. In the meanwhile, mummy answers to daddy and says, he is such a shy fellow, he will not come, I'll have to drag him over here, he doesn't want to meet anybody, forget it. Ah, now mummy has given me a license. So if I continue to be shy and reticent and not meet people, I will not be bothered by them. So I will not have this trouble of going out and saying namaste to every uncle and auntie who comes and asks me the same question, what is your name, which class do you study, what do you want to be when you grow up? I have answered that 320 times and yet nobody seems to be interested. They just ask the question. And if I ask them 10 minutes later, can you tell me now which class I am in? They won't remember. So they were not even interested in knowing which class I am in. It was just a routine that they asked me. I am intelligent enough even in that second standard and fifth standard to know what is happening. But I use it as a means to get away. Now that I have been reinforced by my own mother has told my daddy that no, he is a shy boy, she is a shy girl, she doesn't like to meet, okay. So if I go on being shy, I can get away from this, okay. So momentarily my problem has been solved. But now what happens? My ability to interact with people, to socialize, to, you know, make friends with new people automatically is going down. I have some new friends in school or classmates or something. Somewhere my subconscious is preventing me. I like this boy in the class. I want to go and say hello to them, but no, I'm shy. I'm not capable of making friends or talking properly. So I'll make a fool of myself. Better not do it. Teacher asks a question in class. I know the answer. I can raise my hand and say, no, I might make a mistake. I know the answer, but I may stammer when saying it, I may say it in the wrong way because I'm not good at socializing and talking to people, no? So better I keep quiet. Because I kept quiet, now what happens? These boys think that I am an arrogant fellow, I don't want to make friends, so they stop making any attempt to make friends with me. Teachers see that I am not answering any question, they label me as an ordinary fellow. Parents have already labeled me. So as I am growing, everything starts getting affected. Here one very interesting thing happens. Most growing young people, when they start becoming victims of low self-esteem, they go to either extreme. Either they withdraw completely and say, I can't study. I don't want to do this homework. I am very poor at maths. I don't want to go to this. I don't want to take part in that, you know, quiz activity, I don't want to do this, they go there. Or many, many people do the reverse. I will go on and on and on studying because anyway I am a worthless person. The only thing that I can do is to come first in class so that at least then my daddy will say good, good, good and give me a chocolate and tell others, see my son stands first in the class. So that's how I am trying to redeem myself. I am trying to come out with that thing that I am at least capable in something or the other. And believe me, I don't know if anybody has actually done a research on this, I wish they would do. Vast majority of such children who continuously come first in class or do extremely well in their academics because of low self-esteem never become anything great in life. You would be thinking, this boy who's been topping his class every year is headed for something great. You track him 10 years, 20 years later, he's a very, very mediocre person in all respects. Why? Because he cannot sell himself. When a question paper was given to him and he was supposed to sit and answer that in 3 hours, and when he was given time saying that so-and-so date, no, March 12th will be your this thing, he prepared so well that he went and gave it. Now when he has to go for an interview and then they say, what are your qualities, what are you capable of, he can't. He gets so reticent and so shy and so apprehensive. If I say I am good in English and they point out some mistake, my sentence formation is not correct, and they say, you are saying you are good in English, but just now you used a wrong word or wrong grammar or something of that sort. So better not to say that I'm good in English or whatever skills are being checked.
You know, how would that affect?
Yes. Yeah. False praise definitely affects a child. The child becomes what we call as a pampered child. For anything and everything you are saying that you are so great, you are so good, you are like this, you are like that. Little child comes and draws one duck which to you looks like a gorilla. So you say, what a nice gorilla you have drawn. No, ma, it is a duck. Oh, what a nice duck you have drawn, or something of that sort. You are definitely hurting the child by pampering her ego or whatever it is. And the child starts believing that whatever I do, you know, everybody has to praise me. So tomorrow when she goes to school and she does this drawing and shows it and the teacher comes and says, she may not even put her down. If the teacher just says, this is not a very good painting, she can't take it. And then all sorts of problems start occurring. She will start getting angry with people, she will start playing politics, she will start criticizing why she got the prize in that drawing competition, I was much better, she'll spoil her relationships. And she will be a very disappointed person because finally she will get the fourth prize or something, whereas she was expecting that I was the first. Normally any child would have said, okay, I got the fourth prize. She would say no, because the way I was pampered and I was told that I am the best in everything, how can I come fourth or something of that sort. And this again unconsciously is developed by a lot of parents. I have asked innumerable children, and I still keep asking. Last week also somewhere I was talking to children and I asked them, I said, when you get the report card and you've got six subjects in it and marks for each of the subject is given and the overall percentage or grade or whatever it is given, when you come and show it to daddy, which subject does your daddy first point out to? Unanimously they said, whichever subject I got the lowest. What happened to you in Hindi? But daddy, see, in Kannada I got high marks. That is okay, that's a language. But Hindi, what happened? And vice versa. If it is Kannada which is low, see daddy, Hindi is not my language, but I got that. That's okay, but you have to do well in Kannada. No, how can you? That's the thing that goes on. So when that happens, some children have the resilience. That also I keep checking with children. What do you do when this happens? So there are a lot of children with good self-esteem. Because that's a momentary thing, because the child knows that basically daddy loved me, keeps giving me positive strokes, he doesn't give me put down or whatever it is. But when it comes to academics, this is a routine which I have to go through three times in a year, first term, second term and final term. So when I go prepared, you know, when by the time daddy is looking at it, like some of those dogs do when they want you to feed them, you know, they put on their most pathetic face and keep looking like that with big eyes. So when daddy is scolding two, three times, he keeps looking and he sees those, you know, pathetic eyes looking like that. Sometime or the other, he gets fed up and says, go. And that's the end of it. Thank you very much. It's like the dog who has got the bone now. And he can say, okay, now I can push off. I don't have to put on that pathetic face anymore. Yes, ma'am.
Praise should be accepted,
yeah.
And you should not negate that person saying, no, I don't have this, and there's nothing exclusive about it.
Yes.
Supposing someone is talented and he is getting a lot of praises, there is a possibility he can go into an ego state.
Yeah.
How do we borderline that? Because he is actually talented and
that's right.
How do you
self esteem
over the.
Yeah.
Normally, person who doesn't accept it, our society call him humble.
Yes. Okay. Let me also tell you, society may call it humble, but this is a, you know, 3-minute interaction with which I had, which has left a mark on me. There was an excellent and a very well-known person called Madhav Rao Sindhya. He was the Maharaja and also in politics, and he was the Union Minister for HRD. We had a seminar in Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan in which he was the chief guest, and it was a 2-day seminar. Later in the day I was to give a talk, but the director personally requested and he said, you come for the inauguration also. So I went over there and we were on the stage. The first part was very interesting. He told the people that people are praising me so much. They're going on saying that, you know, Sindhya is such a great man and he's this and he'll do this and he'll do wonder. Now that he has become HRD minister, he will revolutionize the education system in the country and this and that. I want to tell all of you very clearly that if I last out 5 years in this post, and in that period of time, if I can reduce the weight of the school bag by half, I will think that I have achieved something very great. And as we all know, he didn't achieve that. But the more interesting thing was that immediately after the inauguration, there was a tea break, and then he was to leave. So I went and took my tea and I was standing. For some reason, I don't know why, he suddenly saw me and he walked up to me. And he said, have I met you before? I said, definitely not, sir. I would have remembered if I had met you. Then he asked me, aap Delhi aate hain? Kya, have I seen you in Delhi? I said, no, I never come to Delhi. Haan. Isiliye mujhe aisa laga ke, you know, you are a little different. Kyunki Delhi mein kya hota hai malum hai? Ke agar koi politician hai mere jaisa ya koi, aur agar koi usko kehta hai ki ye bade sajjan manus hai. He is a thorough gentleman. So, samjho uska beda tark. Yeah. So, remember that also. That we say that this person is very humble, this person is this, but the unspoken thing is he is good for nothing. If he is so humble and if he is so this and so this thing, let him go and take sannyas and sit on the Himalayas. But I am not going to encourage, I don't want to have these, that sort of thing. So, whether you like it or not, the overwhelming majority of society does not really deep down appreciate people who have, you know, basic good in them. So, on the face of it, you may say, oh, this man is so humble and this and that. You remember 2-3 years back when Anna Hazare rose up as a tornado, people were comparing him to Gandhiji and all that. And one of the things that was being said was so humble, so down to earth, villager, he was an army driver, you are this, you are that and all that. And the moment I started reading those comments in the media, I knew Anna Hazare is going to go back to Rawal Gaon Siddhi and sit over there under the tree. He is not going to come anywhere in power or this or that, and that is what has happened to him today. Because it looked as though we are going to elect him as the leader of the whole country, the way people were leaving their offices, forming chains, coming out, doing everything. Today he is not even an MLA or a Panchayat Samiti member or anything of that sort. Now this is reality of life. I am not going into the do's and don'ts or whether it is right or wrong. But this is the harsh reality. You have to accept this. After years and years and years, when we got a president like Dr. Abdul Kalam, we thought, you know, he is going to be so great. Now, other than being invited to some college functions to come and preside over there, we are not making use of him in any way at all. Such a talented, great person, so humble. He doesn't have egos. You invite him to Banjara, probably, if he is free and if he can come, he will come. We know he is that type of person. But we have just let him off into the wilderness sort of thing. And we have gone back to electing politicians or whatever it is. We haven't even learned a lesson that if you have a capable person as the president, we can achieve so much of this one. So this is reality. So one thing is there. One good point which Manra has, I wanted to tell that also. That's another area of my concern. If you focus on a child who has certain talent and make that talent into the end all and be all, the most classic example being reality shows for that, dance programs and song programs of small children. I agree that some of those children are very, very talented, but they have one talent. That child can sing, or that child can dance, or that child can do whatever it can. Now, life is not restricted to singing and dancing and whatever that child is doing. But what are we projecting to the child? As though you have already become a celebrity. You already made your career, you made everything. And in the end, what happens? Again, I wish somebody would be doing surveys on this and finding out this is at least 10 years old, all these reality shows and all that. Just check out the child who came into the limelight 10 years back. Where is that child today? He's an adult and, you know, where would he be? Including that Salam Bombay boy who is driving an auto rickshaw here in Bangalore or something of that sort. There are innumerable examples. One of the best examples and saddest examples was my own classmate Sajid, who was the son of Nargis in that famous movie Mother India. You see those posters of Mother India even now. She is carrying that plow and walking, and her two sons are there, the elder son. It keeps coming on TV also, Mother India nowadays, in some channel. Just watch that little fellow, the elder of the two children of Nargis. Amazing talent that boy has, unbelievable talent he had. So much so that when Mother India became so popular, they brought out another film in which he was the hero, as a child hero. It was called Son of India. Nanna munna rahi hu, desh ka sipahi hu, bolo mere sang. That was featured on him. Raghu, come.
Sir, coming back to Anna Hazare, I think, this way that the politicians have developed the art of putting
down right.
people's movement.
Exactly.
You can't sustain.
Exactly.
I mean, for people also, meeting the basic needs take most of the time.
That's right.
People who are revolutionaries will say, okay, I'll only do this.
That's right.
It's not
Anna Hazare
per se.
Nothing. Anna Hazare is the same. Arvind Kejriwal today is embroiled in so many controversies, whereas we thought he's a clean politician coming up. Santosh Hegde, justice, did so much work. Ideally, he should have been in line for becoming President of India or something of that sort. Nobody bothered about him. Nobody cares what he is doing. He probably doesn't even have a government car or a telephone or a driver or anything of that sort for all his capabilities. So that's what I was saying, that is real life. This boy, I just wanted to tell you, grew up and became a drug addict. Once two films of his failed, he acted as a hero in two movies when he became an adult, and both of them flopped miserably. And after that, obviously no producer was willing to touch him. And eventually he became a drug addict and he was found dead in a gutter of Bombay. Now this is, I think, a great question, and those were the days where hardly anybody, he was the son of that famous Mehboob Khan, that is why he got this opportunity and all that. Today any common man, your child, my child, can go into reality shows and all that, and you can imagine what is going to happen. So the flip side of it when we talk about it, and this also, the funny part of it is, this can also affect the self-esteem of the child. When the child is told that anything and everything revolves around your singing talent or your dancing talent. And one fine day when the child realizes that I have nothing more to gain in this field, I have been on TV, I have got these prizes, I have got everything. But now as I am growing up, there is no progress or follow up. So what happens at that stage, he has identified himself with his talent so much that minus the talent, he feels I am good for nothing. The other end of the spectrum also, I'd like to tell you, it's not part of the topic today, but just a word on that. People who connect themselves with their designation or their vocation when they retire, because I do a lot of work with people who are retiring, and I realize that if you start identifying yourself with your designation or your, you know, vocation or something of that sort, then you are out of it. When that label is removed from you, your self-esteem takes such a huge plunge, because you have not learnt that you are anything beyond that label that you had with you. The other area, and I think equally important area which we must do, is how do you build back your...
In all these instances of these child reality shows and all that, wouldn't it be the duty of the parents to sort of, in all such instances, to keep the child grounded about the factual, what areas is he good, what he needs to improve, and so on and so forth. The parents play a very primary...
100%, no doubt about it. See, the media, the entertainment industry, the advertisement people, all those people are doing their... they are very clear why they are doing it, whether it is children or old people, whatever the masses want to watch, and wherever the TRPs are there, they will go ahead and do it. If it's not your child, they'll pick up some other child, they'll do something else, they'll have beauty competition, they'll have everything going. But I have to look at my individual, and I think the parents who encourage and send such children to these sort of shows actually need to get their own self-esteem checked out.
Yes.
I am not good enough, so I will make my little one go up so that I can say I am the father of this great child. If I am so keen on developing some this thing, why don't I do it? Whatever area I am good at, why don't I compete and try to become a celebrity or a well-known name or a successful person? I am after all an adult. I can do in whatever field I want to. Why push my child into that and deprive my child of the basic childhood, which I think every child needs? Regardless of how talented that child is, that child needs to go through the childhood. Forget about reality shows. I am also very, very sad when I hear that at 8 years of age, that child was so smart, he passed his SSLC. By 9 years, he passed his this thing, and by 14, he is now doing his master's in something, and he is going to do this or that. What am I achieving? What is the great hurry? Why does he have to, become a super whatever he is at 14 years of age? Why don't I allow the same child to go out and play on the sand or roam around in forest area or something of that sort? That nobody is going to teach him. And that is where we need to look into a lot of these things. And as I said, the important part, that is, how do you build back self-esteem when it is over? Again, the factor remains, the earlier you start, the better are the chances. So if you find that there is a six-year-old whose self-esteem seems to be going down and you work with him, your chances of success are much better than if you work with a 16-year-old or a 36-year-old. But this is not to say that self-esteem cannot be redeemed. Even if a person is 60 years old and if he makes up his mind that, I've lived all my life with low self-esteem, now at this stage I want to start improving or whatever it is, it can be done. It will be a slower process. That's all the thing. One is to explore what were the factors that led to this thing. What I have given in the booklet also, this put down hours and all that. Now here, why many of us don't do it is because supposing my father used to always say, hey, you are good for nothing, yeah, you will grow up and become a rickshaw driver or something. And look at your brother, he is so bright, he stands first in class or something. Now I want to introspect and tell that finally when it came to the board exam, I actually did better than my brother. And not only I didn't become a rickshaw driver, I got a scholarship and I went to one of the best institutes and today I am this. So when I look back, and if I try to, evaluate this thing, the first thing that comes to our mind as Indians is, how can I talk badly about my father? After all, he gave me birth, he loved me. Okay, he did something wrong, but even if I were to share with my best friend that my father used to say this to me, how can I criticize my father? Either he's very old or maybe he's even dead and gone. How can I do it? You have to understand that when you are doing this introspection, people are not important. It is not that individual human being, my father, Mr. So-and-so, but it is the fact that a significant adult whom I respected, adored, and whose word I considered as the absolute truth, he did this to me with all good intentions. Maybe that is the way he wanted me to study higher by comparing me to my brother. Maybe he wanted to shake me up by saying that if you don't study, you'll become a rickshaw driver. So I will get scared and say, no, I don't want to do that. So that's why I will study. All his intentions are good. So I have to start with doing the exploration and express it out. You have to express it out, ideally to a friend, a counselor, whatever it is. If possible, even to the person concerned, in a nice way. Daddy, I have been reviewing. I think you were so concerned about me and you wanted me to do well that you used to do this. You may or may not remember, but you used to use these words like saying that you'll become a rickshaw driver. And somewhere that stuck in my mind and that made me pull on. I remember on occasions where, a teacher was asking, what do you want to do? What is your this thing? Actually, I wanted to be an astronaut, but I realized I couldn't raise my hand and say it because somewhere it was lurking behind me that finally I'm going to become a rickshaw driver and what am I telling about becoming an astronaut? Can I digress with a quick commercial break to tell you the reverse of self-esteem? As I mentioned earlier, I do a lot of work with the armed forces and the air force and all that. So they used to invite me for various programs. There's one particular driver who comes and picks me up in the air force car, since he knows my place and all that. Nice, sweet chap, North Indian, Hindi speaking man. I keep chatting with him. So he used to see that every time that I'm invited, you know, I'm being made to sit on the stage or give a speech, somebody gives me a memento or a whatever, you know, bouquet or whatever. So he knew that this guy is some important fellow, even though he's not in uniform, he gets the same of respect and all that. The commanding officer one day told me that we have a nice microlight aircraft in Jaipur. Would you like to take a spin on that? I said, sure. So Sunday morning, can you come over? I'll take you in that thing. So Sunday early morning, this fellow, poor fellow, his holiday driver was sent over here. He came and picked me up and he took me to Jaipur. And he said, why are we, he was asking me, kya sab Jaipur kyun ja rahe? Because there was nothing happening there. Normally I go when there is a program and there are people waiting. There is nothing happening there. I said, nahi, aapke saab ne bulaya hai to fly there or something I said. And we went over there. He was standing there. I don't know if you've seen a microlight aircraft. It's a very tiny little thing. So anyway, we both got in. And he flew me, took me around, showed me a bird's eye view of the city and this and that. Just 10-15 minutes, we had a joyride, we came down. And then I said, bye-bye, thanks a lot, and we said that, and I got into the jeep. And this man turns to me and said, okay, sir. I said, okay, I came only for this. Iske liye aap? Sir, ye kya hai, sir? Ye hawa mein udne wala auto rickshaw hai. हमारा गाड़ी के जैसा नहीं है साहब एंड ही शोइंग दिस यू नो प्राइड ऑफ हिज जिप्सी जीप यू नो ऑटो रिक्शा उसको चार पहिए भी नहीं है साहब हमारे जीप को तो चार पहिए है उसको तीन पहिए हमारे उनके वाला ऑटो उसके भी नहीं बैठने को आया सो ही एक्चुअली फेल्ट दैट मी सिटिंग इन हिज जीप You know, he's more of an honor than something. Hats off to that man. He's the lowest in the hierarchy of the entire, you know, Indian Air Force. But this is what he firmly believes in, and this is what we should aim for, whether it's for ourselves or something else. So that's why I said expression. It comes. See, even the fact that he had the guts to say it. You know how strict the hierarchy is. Suppose I go and complain to his commanding officer that this man said, hawa mein udne wala auto rickshaw or something like that. That man is in deep trouble. But since he knew that I am friendly, I am not a uniformed person, and we have been chatting so many times, he took that chance. He didn't even say, saab ko nahi bolna or anything of that sort. He was confident that, yes, this is something I am sharing with this guest or something of that sort. Then look for being comforted. You see, what happens is that when we have low self-esteem and we consider ourselves to be not good enough, we start withdrawing from others. I have a friend whose company gives me solace. I have another friend who generally praises me. I have this friend who comes and gives me a warm hug. These are the things that redeem me, that I am a capable person, that I connect and that I am worthy of a hug, I am worthy of a praise, or I am worthy of a discussion or whatever it is. I start withdrawing, consciously start withdrawing if I have got low self-esteem. So start reversing that. Provide that comfort to yourself, particularly through people. Give yourself value by being a little assertive and saying, two of us are going to a restaurant. He says, we will go to that dosa joint. I don't want to eat dosa. Last time we had dosa, I'll take you somewhere where they give you very good pizza and we'll have that. I'm really wanting to have a pizza. Come try it out. If I have low self-esteem, I don't even mention that. No, what will he feel? Because my choice of pizza itself, I start questioning. Whereas, the funny part is, some other time he will say, Arey, what yaar, every time we are going to this dosa joint, only don't you like pizza, he will ask me. And I will say, I thought you liked dosa, you were so happy saying we'll have dosa, that's why I took you over there. So lot of miscommunication, lot of communication gap, all these things can be done. Then you need to compensate. Somebody has put me down. Now, instead of me continuously putting it down, how many counselees I've had who come and say, no, I'm no good at this. Oh, I see. How do you know that? How have you evaluated that? No, my husband says so.
And Ali, I've also experienced that they constantly crave appreciation from external.
External.
And they're just not willing to accept.
Yes. They crave and yet they don't accept. I go on asking you, isn't this a good shot? The moment you say, yes, Ali, this is a very good shot.
I don't think
so. No, I don't think so. This is 5 years old and no one is that good. So I'm looking for that opportunity to see whether you will say it so that I can negate it. So that's what I said, compensate for it now by saying, yes, I am good at this, I am good at that. If I am not good at it, I am improving in that. Earlier, I didn't have a dressing sense and this and that. I didn't have a good dressing sense and this. But now I shall do this. Now I am learning a little more. At this point of time, I will find out what suits me better. Earlier, I never used to bother about my wardrobe or something. Now that I can afford it, I will change my wardrobe. I will get better clothes. I will consult people and check out and find out what looks good on me. Any issue, if you do it across the board and start compensating yourself, that is another positive step. And along with that, you have to, at some point or the other, go through the process of forgiveness. I forgive those people who pulled down my self-esteem. I'm not putting them down, I'm not angry with them, I'm not saying anything, but I know that this is what has caused. So I'm going to make a conscious effort. Whether I go and tell that person or not is secondary. That depends on my relationship with that person. Don't force yourself. But definitely, in your heart of hearts, until you work out that forgiveness, if somewhere you find yourself saying things like, how can I forgive him? He is the one who did this to me. Because of him, this has happened to me. I can't forgive him. You know what that means? He has said 10 nasty things to you. You are adding 5 more by yourself by not forgiving him. It's only when you forgive that you can move forward.
Yes. Do we ignore really?
No, it doesn't. Because you make so much of active effort to ignore. I come in over here and I realize this person is sitting here who always says wrong things to me. So I do this. The moment he leans forward, oh, is he going to talk to me? No, I will do this. So you see, I'm obsessed with that wonderful little anecdote about the two young trees, who are going through the jungle, and there was a pretty girl who wanted to cross and she couldn't, so this one priest picked her up and crossed the thing, and she went away. She said thank you and went away. Half an hour later, the other priest asked this priest, what, father, you are a celibate and you are a religious person. Do you think it was right for you to pick up a young girl in your arms and take her across? So this other priest thinks over and says, yes, I think I should have avoided that. But I picked her up and dropped her in 30 seconds. Why are you carrying her in your heart for another 30 minutes? So that's what happens when you try to ignore. Okay, after that, you come to the perspective. Everything is perspective or perception and this and that. So you have to start changing your perspective, your attitude, your way of approach and looking at things and that sort of thing. And last becomes channeling. How do I actively channel? Now I have to convert it into action. It's not just sitting at home and saying, yeah, now I know I am a good person. No. If I am a better person than what I thought I am, what am I doing about it? I didn't go in for higher studies because at that time it was drilled into me that you are no good and you will do this or that or something. I'll give you a very simple example that happened just a few days back. Here was this man, very rich, very well-to-do person who brought his child for an aptitude test. She's in 10th standard. And I was explaining that, she is more of a right-brained person. It will be better for her to take up arts and she can do so many things in the field of humanities and social sciences rather than take up science. And this man says, yes, that I have seen. He is no good at science. In fact, if I put her in PUC science, it will be a waste of my money. Just look at this statement. Firstly, for a man of that stature, how much extra money is he going to spend from PUC arts to PUC science? What is the difference in fees? Negligible. And secondly, his child, one and only child by the way, if he puts his child to arts or science, it should be because that is better for the future of the child. But that child, now, I had a very brief interaction with her. I don't know how good or how bad is the self-esteem of that child. But if I get a chance, I would like to know if she has been suffering through this all the time. Imagine a simple statement like the father saying, if I put her in science, it's a waste of money. Two things can happen. Either she is interested and she takes up science. She is under so much pressure. My father is spending extra money to put me in science, I better do. That even if she wanted to take science, she will opt for arts because she will say, I don't want to waste my father's money. I'm not capable. One and only child, why is the father earning? For her sake only. But that few thousands, whatever he would have paid extra to put her in science, the child will not accept it. The child will say, I will go ahead and do arts whether I like it or not, because I don't want to waste my father's money or whatever, that sort of thing. These are all the examples that happen. So you actually have to channel it and start putting the thing into action.
Self-affirmations help?
Very much, very much. Very much. When I spoke about the perspective and expression and all that, that is one of the things. I think any person working on self-esteem, like how you do physical exercise or puja or your bath or whatever it is, this should be a part of your daily routine. You must just sit down and say, I am a good human being, I am capable, I am honest, I am this. It should start with a general thing and move on to specifics. If I repeat 100 times I am a good human being, it won't have that effect. I should also define what is a good human being. And that too in human terms, not in terms of I stand first in class or I am a class 1 officer or I am this or that. I am honest. I can look in the mirror and say, yes, I am honest. I have never consciously cheated anybody. I am helpful. I am this. I am that. I am soft-spoken. Go on coming out with your qualities and actions. And if you can even back that up with what you did that day, at the end of the day. Today, I gave a lift. I was leaving from here. I just noticed somebody who is not even a close friend. He seemed to be a little lost. I went up to him and I asked him, do you have a vehicle? Or no, I was wondering how to go to Makri Circle and from there I'll catch a bus. Come, I'll drop you to Makri Circle. I didn't have to do it. He's not my friend or close person. He didn't come and ask me for it, but I did it. Therefore, I'm a good human being. So, smallest of these things, whatever I have done, should be recalled into that. That's how it goes. Yes.
What if the person says, this doesn't help me?
Yeah.
I know I am this person,
yes.
But it doesn't help
yes.
me.
It's very common when you're working with somebody with low self-esteem, the person will say, this doesn't help me, or I'm not capable of doing that, and I've tried out everything and nothing happens. Anyway, I'm good for nothing, that sort of thing. So two things you have to do. One is give space, particularly if it's a known person whom you can interact with. Okay, ma, you think over. I'll meet you next week. Just give that gap. 1 week later, take the initiative, call her up or drop in and say, hi, how's it going? Did you give a thought? First general conversation and this and that. Did you give a thought to what I said? No, I told you no, I don't think it is worth it. Okay, then what are you trying out? Is there any other method which is better than that? Let me know. No, what is the better method anyway? I am useless and this and that. Then you can start pointing out. The other day I saw that you had shot this video when Ali was giving a talk. And later I went through that video on that website, it came out so beautifully. It shows you have somehow you have that talent of media or something of that sort. Do you realize that? Have you cultivated that? Have you done something on that? So you have to pick out specific things and start working on it and then widen them as much as possible. Because if you only encourage her to do something which she's talented in, her confidence in that will go up, but her self-esteem won't go up. So the moment you have got her to agree, next time you ask her to agree to something else. You know, this friend of mine has been feeling very low because she's not doing well in her studies and all that. I think you are the type of person you can talk to her. No, what will I do? I hardly managed to pass when I was a student. That's the reason why, Raj, because maybe you can connect to her better because you've also not been a great scholarly student and all that. So maybe that child will connect better with you. Just give it a chance, for my sake. When she does it, again give her a praise. I met that girl after she had spoken to you and this, and she called me and she told me how nice it was to speak to this auntie or something of that sort. That's how you have to keep building it up till the person comes to that stage. Yeah.
I just ask two questions.
Sure.
One is, I have seen through that all of our leaders, political leaders, are just average people. But do you say
you're being very generous.
you feel that they are having high esteem?
No. Not all of them, some have low self. We can't generalize political leaders as if this thing. Like I told you about Madhav Rao's India.
They're on a scale of 1 to 10.
They're
just average.
I know.
The second question is, do we have to cross examine us introspection? What do you say?
That is what?
No. Every time, strike a balance between good and bad.
No.
To judge ourselves as self-esteem,
yes.
We have to put both the things on the scale.
Yes, yes, yes.
And we have to strike a balance.
Yes.
Which is good, which is bad.
Yes.
Do we have to do
that on a regular basis? Yes, you have to do that on a regular basis. And please understand, what we call bad may not be bad. If I say, I don't have the confidence of riding a motorcycle, or I am not good in maths, we tend to put it as bad. Because that's what was instilled in us. My teacher told me, if you can't do this 4th standard maths, what will you do when the time you come to 10th, etc. I am not proficient in maths. Maths is not my cup of tea. I am lagging behind in maths, fine. But it is not a bad quality of mine. I can't ride a motorcycle. I tried also a number of times. Somehow I couldn't latch on to it. I have given it up. I don't want to learn how to ride a motorcycle. It's not a bad quality.
But I have seen people who have got high esteem are called Lash Dimag, you know, Lash Dimag. Lash Dimag means they do the act,
yes,
then they start thinking whether they have done good or bad.
I know. That's a different ball game altogether, and so we have to look into that also. Yeah.
How do you build self-esteem in adolescents? Because
yeah,
adolescents are not, especially as a parent, they're not willing to listen to you. So what can you do as a parent to build
Adolescents, as per my experience, are more than willing to listen. They want somebody to tell them in their language and in the right way. I gave you this example of the child who brings home the report card and the father points out to the one that he's got lowest marks in. Now the same father is trying to give him a pep talk and say, come, I'll tell you, I have this friend who is a doctor, come and meet her, and you'll get to know what medicine is all about, and I want to help you with that. I don't know. When I go to this doctor auntie, my father may turn to her and say, he is getting only 50% in biology, I don't know what doctor he will make. So better I will avoid. So here is father with very good intention going on telling the child, come, I'll help you to explore careers or this or that, and he doesn't want to listen. So there are reasons. By the time a child comes to adolescence, he has already been negated so many times. Most of the time, we don't even allow the child to complete a sentence. Supposing your child were to come home from college and say, I saw a lovely movie today. We had that boring 2 lectures in the afternoon, so I bunked that and I went to this movie. It was such a wonderful movie and I want to tell you all about it. You bunked 2 classes. Now after that, why is he going to listen now? Now I'm not going to say you condone that action of bunking the class. At that time when he is talking happily about that movie, listen to him thoroughly, enjoy with it, from good things that he has to say about the movie, even say, okay, now that you have liked it, maybe I can't go to the theater, maybe we'll get a DVD. Can you get me a DVD sometime? No, ma, I know these new movies, they are not available. I will get it to you after 15 days, then it will be very easy. I'll download it from this. All this thing comes out. Then, separate time you sit down and talk to him and say, I need 10 minutes of your time, I want to discuss about the kind of ways. Few things like you said, that sometimes you are bunking classes to see this movie or something of that sort. What do you feel about that? How is your attendance going? You know that if you get less than 75%, they may not allow you to sit for the exam or something. Like that you go on separating it out and then talking. And every talk to your child should start with listening. If you listen to him 5 different times, 6 times, he will definitely listen to you, there's no doubt about it. Yes.
I mean, you have to emphasize, because in Dr. Bhavani's class we learned that there is nothing called high self-esteem.
Exactly.
There is self-esteem and low self-esteem.
That's what I said.
The comparison of self-esteem as such. That is his own self-esteem. Somebody is not higher than that.
That's exactly what I said, because people think if, like child, my adolescent, if I keep praising him too much, he will get such a high self-esteem that he will get a boosted ego. If I say, oh, very good in your maths, you went from 40 to 45, great and all that, he'll say, okay, mother's very happy with 45, no, so I'll stop studying. So I don't want to praise him for that progress that he has made. That's a fallacy. If you put it in the right way and help him to understand, let's see, 45 doesn't really get you anywhere. The world is a cruel place. They are going to ask you how many marks you got and then only give you admission for college or whatever it is. But I can tell you that I am very happy that you made that effort. Marks wise it may not be very great, your teacher may have actually scolded you for getting 45, but I tell you I am proud of you that you made that attempt. So now that you have gone from 40 to 45, in the next exam can you go from 45 to 55? How much do you think you can go up to? What is holding you back? No, I am that trigonometry, I am good, but it is algebra that brings down my marks. What do you do about that algebra? Is there somewhere somebody can help you to do this? Can you do that or this or that? Again, you see, I am spending 40,000 rupees for your tuition and you say you don't like algebra. Guaranteed to make him hate algebra after
that. Is business return on investment.
Return on investment, that's right.
So would you say try to focus and appreciate the action rather than the result?
Effort.
Effort.
That's such a great tool, I can tell you, to help people to build up their self-esteem, to be a better adult looking after children. Always appreciate the effort of the child. Simplest example I'll tell you, which happens day in and day out. There's a long division which involves 5 steps. The child got 3 out of 5 steps correctly, 2 went wrong. What does the teacher look at? The answer. And the moment the answer is wrong, she puts a big red cross and says, stupid fellow, still can't do such a simple thing, do it once again. Already his motivation has gone down because he has been shouted at and he has been screamed at. He has not been appreciated for 3 out of 5 steps correctly. He should have got 60% marks. No teacher will give him 60% marks for that thing. Okay. Anyway, he pushes himself. He somehow develops that motivation and he does it second time when he gets 4 out of 5 steps correct. He has progressed. And what does the teacher say?
It's still wrong.
Not still wrong. Second time, you stupid fella. I don't know why I'm wasting time with you, going on making you do it again and again and again. You'll never do it correctly. Forget it. Now, what do you think happens to the self-esteem of the child? His efforts and this. So, effort. You did it. You got all 5 steps wrong. Appreciate it. You got 2 steps right. Appreciate him even more. That means you are progressing. Record progress, not the absolute terms. Compare with himself, not with the others. Comparison is another great enemy of self-esteem. The moment you start comparing somebody with something else, you had it. Mothers who keep comparing their child with others, I always tell them that you make excellent food for your husband, his favorite dish, and he comes and thoroughly enjoys himself and takes second and third helping and all that. And at the end of it, he says, yeah, it was good, but not as good as Mrs. Rao makes next door. You feel like taking the remainder of that and putting it over his head. But don't we do it all the time to
children? Example that is there. Okay. The husband says that the neighbor lady, she makes masala. So, I bought the masala. I have made it masala.
Masala. She didn't put it over his head. Okay, some important announcements. We have overshot the time today. As you know, we meet on the third Thursday of every month here. Next one.